Have you ever found yourself in a place where you have just felt bitter, angry, upset, unforgiving, and in a real sense, you almost didn't want to come out of it? You almost enjoyed seething? Well, we need to talk about bitterness today. I'm Bishop Manuel Grady. This is the Life Lifters Broadcast. What do you say? Let's get into it. Hey guys, thanks for joining me today for the Life Lifters broadcast. I want you to get something to drink, warm or cold, whatever your preference is. I want you to get your Bibles, and we're going to talk about something today. We're going to talk about how bitterness blocks blessings. How bitterness blocks blessings. So we're going to get into this. We're going to talk about it, be transparent, and I want you to have an open heart, an open mind, an open spirit, and I think we can get healed. Let's pray. Father, we thank you right now for giving us the opportunity to come together and to be able to receive the word of God and open our hearts that we may understand, open our ears that we may hear, open our spirits so we may listen to what the Holy Spirit would have to say to us today. So thank you once again for joining us here today. I want to talk to you about how bitterness blocks blessings. And I want to read from Ruth chapter 1, probably just 5 verses or so. Ruth, the book of Ruth, chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. And I'm going to read it from the contemporary English version. It says this: long ago in the days before Israel had a king, there was a famine in the land. So a man named Elimelech, who belonged to the clan of Ephrath, who lived in Bethlehem of Judah, went with his wife Naomi and their two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, to live for a while in the country of Moab. And while they were living there, Elimelech died, and Naomi was left alone with her two sons, who married Moabite women, Orpah and Ruth. About 10 years later, Mahlon and Chilion also died, and Naomi was left all alone without husbands or sons. And goes on to say in verse 19 of chapter 1, they went on until they came to Bethlehem. They had left Moab at this particular time. And when they arrived, the whole town became excited. And the women there exclaimed, "Is this really Naomi?" And she said, "Don't call me Naomi. Call me Mara, because Almighty God has made my life bitter. When I left here, I had plenty, but the Lord has brought me back without a thing. So why call me Naomi when the Lord Almighty has condemned me and sent me trouble?" This then was how Naomi came back from Moab with Ruth, her Moabite daughter-in-law, when they arrived in Bethlehem. The barley harvest was just beginning. Now, to set this up, I want you to understand, as we said in verse 1, that here is Naomi. And I want to talk about Naomi more so than Ruth. This is the book of Ruth. It's about redemption. The whole Bible is about redemption. But I want to talk about Naomi because sometimes she's overlooked or she's given kind of a bad rap for how she felt. But we have to understand what she went through. So here she is living with her husband, Elimelech, and things are going pretty well. And they're living in Bethlehem of Judah. But then a famine comes along. Something comes along that disrupts her life, disrupt their lives, and causes them to have to leave from a familiar place. I don't know about you, but if you've ever been uprooted from something familiar or a place that's familiar or a system that's familiar or a life that's familiar, it can really be weighing on the soul. And especially when you don't understand why things are going the way that they're going. A lot of the bitterness and the hurt that we feel, and sometimes the undesignated unforgiveness. And I say it like that because many times we don't know that we're having things build up in our hearts. We don't know that we're having negativity build up in our hearts. And we have to find a way to get loose from this. We can't be blessed until we forgive. And bitterness blocks every blessing that God intends for us to have. Now, here's this woman, Naomi, and she's got these two young boys, and perhaps they're not grown yet. And so they leave and they go to a land called Moab. Moab is a place that means God or king. Elimelech, his name means God or king. Mahlon, the son, means weak or sick or afflicted. The other son, Chilion, his name means destruction. Names are significant in the Bible. They indicate the nature of a thing. It's true today. It was true then. But in the Bible, it's very symbolic because it lets us know the intent of God from telling us in telling us a story. Now, the name Moab means who is your father or what is your father? So let's look at this. They are leaving a certain place. Here this man is a king, a leader, someone respected. But he's got to go to a place that he is not related to. And the place is, who is your father? It's not a place of recognition. It's not a place of comfort. It's not a place where he has any idea how he's going to make it with his family. All he knows is he's trying to escape what is a famine in the place of his birth. And so he has these sons with him, and by their very name, their sons' names begin to dictate to us or to show us or to reveal to us that they don't have much of a future to hope for. And so they get there, and here's Naomi probably setting up house and expecting, well, we'll just be here for a while, or maybe we'll find a way to make our fortune here. Maybe things will get better. But in the midst of expecting better, her husband dies and she's left alone with just her two sons. So she's trying to make the best of it. And the two sons, they marry what some scholars believe are two sisters. They marry a sister named Orpah and a sister named Ruth. They are Moabite women. They are women from another land, women who are not included in the birthright or in the ancestry of where they just came from in Bethlehem of Judea. So about 10 years later, these two sons die. So here we have three widows. Naomi and her two daughter-in-laws. The sons are gone. Now, you have to understand the culture here now, because in this day and time, to not have a husband, to not have a son, to not have progeny to carry on the family name or to make a living for you, to make sure that you're provided for, leaves you in a very precarious situation. And so a woman who was once a stand-up pillar of the community, along with her husband, has found herself or is finding herself in a strange land, and where she thought things were going to get better, and now she's beginning to feel closed in. Her name, by the way, means pleasant. Her name means one that is desirable to be around. So she has this name that represents her character. Before all this goes down, everybody wants to go to Naomi's house or be around Naomi because Naomi is the homemaker, the one that has the soul food Sunday, and things are going wonderful in her life. But then comes life. In verse 19, we get down in chapter 1, and it says in the book of Ruth that they were leaving. They decide, we're going to go back to Bethlehem, Judah, and they're going to leave Moab. But then there comes a place where there is a dividing point. And so they go on until they get to Bethlehem. And when they arrive, the whole town is excited. But we have to back up and understand that something has happened here. Ruth has decided to stay with Naomi. Naomi has tried to tell Ruth and Orpah, she's tried to tell them, listen, there's no reason with you guys going with me. I don't have anything to offer you. Why don't you go back to Moab where you're from? At least maybe you could find some of your relatives, or maybe you can get a fresh start there. And so they're there at the crossroads, and they're crying. And so what happens is that Ruth decides that she's going to go with Naomi, but Orpah doesn't see a need to go with Naomi. She wants to go back to what's familiar. We'll get back to that later, but she abandons Naomi. She goes back to what's familiar, but Ruth will not take no for an answer. Ruth is in the process of saying, listen, where you go, I'm going to go, and your God will be my God. And so they trek on and they come to Bethlehem. And when they arrive in Bethlehem, the whole town is excited. They're looking and they're saying, hey, this is a woman that was an upstanding woman in a family and a pillar of our community. We're glad to have them back. And the women there said, is this really Naomi? The pleasant one is finally back. But then Naomi says something that's chilling. Naomi says, call me Mara. Mara means bitterness. She says, I don't want to hear anything about pleasantries. I don't want to hear anything about what's to be desired. I am so wounded in my spirit that I have resolved myself just to be identified with bitterness. She literally wants them to call her what she feels like she's trapped in. She's going to be answering to this. Do you not understand that if they prescribe or subscribe to what she wants them to do, then they're going to be saying, hey, bitterness, you want to come over for dinner? Hey, bitterness, how's your day going? Hey, bitterness. She has literally told them to change her name to bitterness because that's what she feels like she's trapped in. She says, don't even call me Naomi anymore. And then here's something that's strange that I think we all do. She puts her bitterness and her life's plight. She puts it in the lap of God. She says, it's Almighty God who has made my life bitter. Now, I want to talk to you about this for a variety of reasons and what we're experiencing in our lives today. Number one is it's a personal thing that we have to deal with. That's the foremost and most important part. Number two, as I look at the injustice that's happening in our nation, one thing I know from history and from God and from how God deals with injustice, he always extracts vengeance. He always repays. He always balances the weights. It may take 10 years. It may take a few decades. It may take 100 years, but God will always have justice arise. And when justice arises, sometimes the people who have been treated unjustly may not necessarily know the full benefit of seeing the justice. So it looks like that God lets people that do things that are unkind to us and people that treat us wrong, it looks like God lets them get away with it. But I want you to know, no one gets away with anything. Now, I'm saying that to say that while we are in this position in our nation of dealing with injustice, it could very well be that God will balance in our lifetimes, God will balance the scales. But what happens when he balances the scales with the people that have been oppressed? Will we repeat history and will we become the oppressors of the next generation? Will we let our bitterness cause us not to forgive? I'm telling you, to live by the word of God is challenging sometimes. Let me show you what I mean. Even when Jesus realized that Judas was going to betray him. Because see, Jesus as a man, God gave him revelation progressively. It's not that he knew all things instantly. The Christ part of Jesus did. Don't get me wrong. He's all man, but he's all God. So there were things that God revealed to Jesus in due season. And he revealed the betrayal of Judas to Jesus when the time was appropriate. And it said that the one that dips the sop with me is the one that's going to betray me. But what strikes me is that the same way that Jesus is feeding the other 11 disciples, he's also feeding Judas. You really have to know who you are in God to be able to treat those that you know are doing you wrong or have the propensity or desire to do you wrong and take them and still treat them with the humanity that God dictates that we are to treat people with. So Jesus is feeding his enemy, knowing his enemy is going to betray him. Now that's the spirit of God inside this human man that we call Jesus that makes him untouchable as it relates to my righteousness or your righteousness. And I don't know how we can ascribe to that except for the Holy Spirit helping us. That's the only way I see that we can ever muster up the kind of things that God wants us to muster up as far as character definition when it comes to how people treat us. So to my people of color, as God fights the battle for the oppressed, as he always does, and I know he will, what will we become as a people in another 50 years when perhaps the tables will have turned? All through history, we see people who've oppressed other people lose their position of authority because justice is always going to be wrought by God. But the issue becomes, what will we do once those who have done us wrong, we have our opportunity to have our foot on their neck? That's why God works on our inner man, because you never know how things are going to turn out. That's why you have to treat everyone with kindness and the love of Christ, because the people that you meet on your way up, you'll also meet on your way down. And we also have to know this, that vengeance is belonging to the Lord. It didn't just belong to the Lord in past tense. It belongs to the Lord now, present tense, ongoing. And so we see now that she's become bitter, and she's bitter due to bereavement. When something has hurt you or left your life, there's a bereaving, there's a weeping, there's a mourning in your spirit. And people talk about the seven stages of grief, and I believe that that's very true. You go through these stages when you lose something or you lose someone. Grieving is not always just about someone dying in the physical. Grieving has processes that even come into our lives when things happen to us spiritually or happen to us in just the general course of life. And part of the grieving process is denial and then anger. And that anger stage is where it gets dangerous. See, our country right now, many people are angry and rightly so. Many people are upset and rightly so. But it becomes a challenge to deal with the anger and not sin, to be angry, as the Bible says, and sin not. Because if we displace our anger, we will walk in bitterness, and the same God that's fighting for you now, the same God that's fighting for us now as a people or individually, the same God that's fighting for you now will cease to be obligated to fight for you if you work out your own salvation in bitterness, if you work out your own life in bitterness, if you work out your own situation in bitterness. God will not be obligated to work on our behalves when we allow bitterness to permeate through our hearts. And so she is bereaved, and then she's dislocated. Our African-American segment of society has been dislocated. We were taken as a people from our continent and brought to another continent in slavery. We've been dislocated. It seems that if anybody has a right to be angry and bitter, it would be us. But we are in a place now of being challenged, not only because we're going to see God vindicate us, but what will we be and how will we behave after he vindicates us? How are you going to behave when God does bring you out on top? You see, we say a lot of things now, like, you know, I'm just doing me and God's fighting my battles and vengeance is the Lord. And we talk about, and we rightly should talk about, and expect great things and deliverance from God. But the reality comes, how will I behave when now I have the upper hand after having the underhand so long? And so she's dislocated. She's dislocated from what she knows. She's dislocated from what she understands. She's dislocated from life. And on top of everything else, what comes usually with a lot of dislocation is poverty. We talk about that today in our racial scenario. We're talking about reparations and things of restoration. And that needs to be a discussion that needs to be had, because many people out there, whether it was in this particular generation or in your ancestral generation, there are many of us who have had our generational wealth stolen from us. We've had our ancestral rights stolen from us. And we are living in poverty when perhaps there was a time that we had substance and sustenance in life through our tribes or our ethnicity or our nation or where we come from. And now we're at a place where perhaps we're in poverty, at least in poverty relative to what this nation understands as poverty. And so the bitterness she feels is also a perception of her condition. And we can't let the conditions that we end up in cause us to be bitter in our hearts, to be upset, because what happens is we become distorted by self-absorption. If you leave yourself to your bitterness long enough and you just sit and you marinate and you soak in it, all of a sudden you become self-absorbed, and then everybody's against you. Nobody wants you to make it. Everywhere you look, it seems like nothing ever happens right for me, and you get into a very bad situation. This is how Naomi came back. She came back to Moab with her daughter-in-law, but she comes back, listen, she comes back at a time where the barley harvest is just beginning. The Bible puts that there for a reason, because a harvest can represent hope. But listen, whatever a man sows, a man has to reap. And if you have bitterness in your heart, if you have bitterness in your spirit, then what you are setting up is a reaping of the bitterness that you are sowing. So it's very important to give God all of our bitterness and say, God, this makes me mad. This makes me angry. It doesn't even matter if God in your mind is the source of it, like Naomi. Naomi says, it's God that put all this on me. It is God that, especially those of us who feel that we have given our lives to serve God, and something unfortunate has happened or something unfathomable has happened, and we're looking and say, what is the point of serving you, Lord, if all the malady that comes against people that don't know you comes against the ones that do know you? What's the point? What is the benefit? And it's a real hard question to answer. But that's where faith comes in, because in faith, either you believe or you don't. Faith is not something that you can just turn the pages of a fact and say, this is why I believe. Faith is being able to believe in the face of adversity, even when things look like they're not going, or even when they are not going the way that you think they should go. Anybody can stand up and say, I have faith, when all the T's are crossed, the I's are dotted, while there's money in the bank and things are going your way. But faith is reserved for those times that seem dark and without answers. That's where God begins to build our faith. See, Naomi felt her reaping was unjust and unfair. She felt like life had given her something that was unjust and unfair. Up to this point, we have been given no indication that Naomi nor her deceased husband did anything unethical, immoral, or sinful to bring this upon them. It was simply they left an environment that was going through a shift. They had nothing to do with the famine. All this man was trying to do was feed his wife and feed his sons and subsequently feed his daughter-in-laws. So it could be, I want to talk to you for a minute about the mess in the middle, okay? Because where we always trip up is between the promise and the fulfillment of that promise, the prophecy and the fulfillment of that prophecy. It is always the middle, in the midst of it, where we mess up, where our tongue gets out of whack, where our faith gets out of whack. Could it be that they left Bethlehem before seeing the faithfulness of God? Because why did they leave Bethlehem? They left because of a famine. They left because there was a place and a scenario, a situation of need. And it caused them to make a cognitive decision that they had to go somewhere and find a way to sustain the family. But we see here just a little while later that it's harvest time in Bethlehem. When they go back, the people are at the point of rejoicing. They're happy to see Naomi. They're happy to see their kinfolk come back. But the ones that have been gone had not been there to see the reversal of fortune, the reversal of the economy, the reversal of things that were going wrong. And I'm wondering what may have happened had they stayed. Well, had they stayed, perhaps they'd be there. Maybe the sons would be alive. We don't know how they died. We don't know whether it was from the environment. We don't know whether it was from uprising of thieves, bandits. We're not told how or why they died. So we don't know if that's related to their leaving. But let's just look at the fact that maybe even Naomi would be in a better place. But two things we know. One thing we know in two fashions is that neither Ruth nor Orpah would be there. Neither one of them would be with Naomi at this point. So in some ways, God has used this for a greater purpose. Now, understand this. The people in the Bible didn't know they were in the Bible. We have the benefit of reading ahead. We have the benefit of knowing how it turns out. And that's where the frustration is. We're reading this Bible. We're reading the story of these women. And if we've read it one time, we know that there is an ending, an expected ending that's going to happen. So we can't really share in the fullness of the suspense of the story. See, I'm one of those people that when I'm reading a book or when I'm watching a movie, I absolutely hate it when somebody spoils the movie or the book, or when someone tells me what's going to happen. Now, my wife, on the other hand, she's a little bit different. She's like, what's he going to do? If she knows I've watched the movie and she's watching it, she wants me to tell her what's going to happen. She doesn't want anything to jump out and scare her. I don't know what the deal is, but she's just wired differently. But that I hate that. I go through great pains not to end up accidentally figuring out or walking in on a movie. I don't watch things from the middle. If I don't watch it from the beginning and enjoy the plot, then I don't have an enjoyment out of it. Because as much as I love the ending, I enjoy the process. Now, when it comes to life, not so much. I might know that God is going to bless, he's going to deliver, but that doesn't mean that I enjoy the process. But unlike the movie that you can stop, pause, fast forward, and rewind, in life, the process must play out. And if there's any chance, if there's any possibility of you aborting or derailing what God has for you, it's going to happen in the middle. Here we are almost to the end of the trial and tribulation, and all of a sudden words come out of our mouth, negative words come out of our mouth, or we quit, we turn back, we say things like Naomi, I'm just bitter, forget it, and we don't know that we may be one day, one month, one mile, one change from the change, one minute from the breakthrough, and we get into a place and we end up doing something or saying something that's not pleasing to God, and we go through all of this only to forfeit in the last turn of the race. Listen, a loving God works through our lives even through disappointment. God knows when we're disappointed, and He wants us not to become bitter in the disappointment. He does not want us to become weary in well-doing, because in due season, He will do. In D-U-E season, He will D-O. When it is time for certain things to manifest, God will manifest certain things. And so what God is saying is that I'm going to work through your life disappointment. Why? Because the whole culmination of anything you live through is for God to get the glory. And He cannot get the glory without there being a story. He cannot get the glory of I'll use our example of how after 10 years of not being able, 12 years of not being able to conceive a child throughout our 20s and the beginning of our 30s, suddenly He gives us a beautiful child. But if it wasn't for that, I could not speak to parents now who feel like they may never give birth, may never have a child, may never have the family that they wanted. My wife and I have lived through something that we saw the end of. And that God got the glory from, and He continues to get the glory from. You see, and when we sit and we talk to younger people, younger couples, and I can tell in their eyes when we're trying to encourage them that they want to believe us, and perhaps they do believe us, but they are so much in the mist, in the middle of what they're going through. It just seems miles and years away from a breakthrough or an answer. And so, my wife and I are looking at each other and we're saying, you got to trust us. We've been there. We've come on the other side of that. But there's something about being in it that you get it perhaps in your spirit, but the enemy messes with you up here. This is where the battle goes on. This is where the resentment, the lack of faith happens. It happens because we need our minds to be renewed and transformed. And so the arrival of Naomi and Ruth in Bethlehem coincides with the barley harvest. Pay attention to what I'm saying to you now. Their arrival as really refugees, as it were, at least Ruth is. Naomi is returning home, but their arrival in their worst season, watch this, coincides with the best season in Bethlehem, the house of what? The house of bread. And so Naomi, because she is from Bethlehem, gives Ruth, who is an alien, as it were, permission to glean those fields where she is allowed. What if they would have built a wall around Bethlehem so that you couldn't have any immigrants? We wouldn't have any Ruth. And in a minute, you're going to see why that would be very, very disadvantageous to our lives. What if they had built a wall and wouldn't have allowed the refugee in? And so Ruth ends up working in the field that's owned by Boaz. When a servant begins to identify her, a servant identifies her to him and says, hey, that's Naomi's daughter-in-law. And so it happens that Boaz is a kinsman of Naomi's late husband. Look how God will arrange things in the midst of things. Look how God will fix things in the middle of things. We're just beginning to see this unfold. And so what Boaz does is he tells her to work with the female servants, and then he warns the young men not to bother her. Don't harass her. Don't bother her. Don't push up on her. And so she's protected. And then at mealtime, he invites her in to share his food, because when God is working in the middle, there's always provision and there's always protection. He provided for Ruth, and then he protected Ruth. He protected her from those that would do her harm in the process of what she was in. Well, what happens later is that Naomi learns that Ruth has got the attention of Boaz. She's got the kindness of Boaz. And so she counsels Ruth directly in how to behave in front of Boaz. You see, Boaz is a representation of Christ. Okay, Ruth is a representation of us. And in the middle of being left out, shut out, where Ruth could be bitter like Naomi has become, she's beginning to learn the ways of how to act and behave in front of Boaz slash our type of Jesus. And so even in Naomi's bitterness, Naomi has the presence of mind because she's a kinsman of Boaz. She's related to Boaz. You can see Naomi as the Jew, and you can see Ruth as the Gentile. Naomi is part of the chosen people, and Ruth is part of the adopted people grafted in. And so she has relationship already as the Jewish people had with God. But it is Jesus that brings the bridge. This is Boaz bringing the bridge to let Ruth partake of what Naomi has known. And so she tells her, she says, come on, put on your best attire and go down to the threshing floor. And don't make yourself known to the man before he's finished eating and drinking. But when he lies down, take note of the place where he lays down. She says, and uncover a place at his feet and lie down, and then he'll tell you what to do. And so she is given direction, which is setting up, and Naomi doesn't even know it. She is setting up her own blessing. Thing I want to tell you about bitterness is what you've heard probably a few times before. It's like drinking poison and hoping someone else dies. It's like drinking poison and hoping someone else dies. Ephesians 4:30 says, don't grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you are sealed until the day of redemption. Now listen to this. He says, let all bitterness, all wrath, all anger, and all tumult, all evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. In other words, bitterness, wrath, anger, tumultuousness, evil speaking, malice grieves the Holy Spirit. And I cannot expect blessings from the Holy Ghost. I cannot expect revelation from the Holy Spirit. I can't read my Bible and expect to understand my Bible because the Holy Spirit gives indication of knowledge. I can't even get close to God without the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is grieved by bitterness. So when I am bitter, I am literally ruining the relationship between me and Christ. There is something the Bible calls bitterness of soul. Let me read this to you in Job. And it says, Job 21:23, one dies in his full vigor, being wholly at ease and secure. Some people die after a wonderful life, having succeeded at what they wanted to accomplish, and they die empty, which means every book in them they wrote, every play in them they wrote, every business idea in them they were able to extract and act upon. They die empty without anything in them that they were supposed to leave in the earth. They die with vigor, wholly at ease and secure. His pails, the Bible says, are full of milk, and the marrows of his bones are moist, meaning basically that he has sustenance and he dies after living a good and healthy life. But verse 25 says, another dies in bitterness of soul, never having tasted of prosperity. Bitterness will block prosperity. And this is why I say bitterness blocks blessing. And when I say blessing, I'm not just talking about prosperity of money. When the Bible talks about prosperity, it's talking about the prosperity of soul, of life, of sustenance and finance. Remember, one dies in full vigor, being wholly at ease and secure, full of milk, his pails full of milk, and his marrows full of moist, his bones have moist marrow in them, which means there's youth and vitality there. So that's prosperity. It's not just about money, you see, but bitterness blocks the vigor. Bitterness blocks living at ease. Bitterness blocks the feeling of security. Bitterness blocks us having our pails full of milk. It blocks us having good health and having our marrow of bones be moist. Bitterness of soul is what the Bible calls depression. Did you know that? You won't find the word depression in the Bible. But bitterness of soul is what we call depression. And you will find that in many places in the Bible, in the Word of God. So we have to understand that bitterness is something that God wants us to let go. We have to understand as a people that may be of color, if you're people that have been oppressed, and you could have been a people that's oppressed and not be of color. Maybe you have a Jewish background, or maybe you a part of the early turn of the century. Well, the last two centuries, turn of the century, in the 1700s, 1600s, the Irish and the people that came over. Maybe you have been oppressed in some way, and bitterness has come up in your life because the enemy has seen to it that every culture be oppressed. But right now, what's happening in our nation just so happens to be happening with the African American nation, with the African American. It just so happens now that we are the ones that are in the midst of dealing with great injustice that has not gone anywhere, as our news has let us so eloquently know and see. But the important thing is, as God brings vindication, even restoration, and if he chooses to, reparations, are we going to avoid becoming a bitter society? I think one of the things that the white society fears the most is that if justice is meted out, I feel that perhaps there are those that are afraid that this would turn into a reverse race war. Maybe that's the fear that is really causing some not to sit down and say, we were wrong, we need to make reparations, or we need to make sure that we have given full access to all races in this nation. That could be very well the blockage, because they fear retaliation. Others fear retaliation. That's why we have to practice forgiveness. Forgiveness is the key to loosing the bitterness from our souls. Their stories end very interestingly. Ruth is so interesting to me because it is Ruth that helps to rehabilitate Naomi, because bitterness requires healing. And Ruth, because she is such a submitted and a loving daughter-in-law, positions herself for blessing, that God can open up blessing to Ruth. Watch this. And by blessing Ruth, God is able to heal the bitterness of Naomi. Ruth becomes an ancestor of Jesus. I'm wearing a shirt that says, I'm busy making my ancestors proud. And part of making your ancestors proud is becoming everything that God wants you to be, because our ancestors now, if they have lived for God, they are now with God. They know how the story ends. They know that they have overcome, and that all the plight that they had to go through, whether it was through segregation or whether it was through slavery, they're with Jesus now, those that live for the Lord while they were on earth. And now they see what the end is. And so forgiveness will make my ancestors proud, because they will see that I am able to join them in that great cloud of witnesses in the sky. And I cannot do that if I don't have a forgiving spirit, or if I walk in bitterness. The Bible says in Ruth chapter 4, verse 13, so Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. And he went into her, and the Lord gave her conception, and she bore a son. Now listen to this. Listen to how someone whose spirit was loving and pure and loyal and dedicated, like Ruth was to Naomi, listen to how God has blessed others through this one woman, Ruth's obedience, Ruth's purity. Now Naomi, who was bitter, is blessed because of Ruth. Watch this. Verse 14, then the women said to Naomi, blessed be the Lord, who has not left you this day without a redeemer. And may his name be renowned in Israel. It is Naomi who got redemption. Naomi, the one that was bitter, because she went back to a place and let the people around her just love her, even when she wanted to be bitter, because she found it in herself to train Ruth how to behave in this new and strange land to Ruth. Even through her bitterness, she somehow began to let it go. And now the women are singing Naomi's praises. Verse 15, they said, he shall be to you a restorer of life and a nourisher of your old age. When you forgive and let bitterness go, your life gets restored. Your nourishment comes back. Excitement comes back. Life and vitality comes back. He shall be to you a restorer of life. And then they say, for your daughter-in-law who loves you. This is a scripture. Your daughter-in-law who wouldn't let you go. If you know someone that's bitter, don't let them go. If you know someone that's hurting because of how life has treated them, don't let them go. Don't cut them off because you can't stand to be around them because they're so bitter. And I know it may be hard when people are negative, but sometimes your love will cause bitterness to melt from people's lives. They said because your daughter-in-law who loves you, who is more to you than seven sons. That is a powerful thing to say in this culture where women were devalued and only the males were valued. And this woman is more valuable now to Naomi than seven sons. And they say she's the one that's given birth to your Redeemer. And verse 7, watch this, verse 16 says that Naomi took the child, watch this, and laid them on her lap and became his nurse. Naomi is able to embrace this child. God is replenishing and restoring her, and the bitterness is leaving her life because now she is able to nurse a child. God will not engage her into nursing a child when all she can give through her nursing is bitterness. This is an indication and a testimony that healing has come to Naomi. And the Bible says that the women of the neighborhood gave him a name, saying a son has been born to Naomi. See, people will call you blessed. They will call what comes out of you blessed. They named him Obed. Obed was the father of Jesse. And Jesse was the father of David. Wow. So here, in all of the wrong things that seemingly happened in the life of Naomi, and all of the death, the loss of her son, the loss of her husband, the poverty, she went through poverty when there was a drought in Bethlehem and she left, and then things got rough in the place that she left and she had to go back. Somebody today needs to return back to your place of blessing, even though it seems like you went through a hard season in the middle. And now, Obed, the grandfather of David, David being in the lineage of Christ. You see, so in essence, Naomi became busy making her ancestors proud, and now she's become busy being an ancestor of Jesus. But what if Orpah? What if Orpah, the one that decided not to go, maybe she couldn't deal with the bitterness of Naomi. Maybe she couldn't deal with the way things went. We understand from ancient rabbi writings that Orpah is also identified by another name, Herse, H-E-R-S-E. Orpah, who did not go with Ruth, who did not go with Naomi, she becomes the mother of four Philistine giants, one of whom was named Goliath. While Naomi, while Ruth are in the lineage of Jesus, more specifically, while Ruth becomes an ancestor of David, Orpah becomes an ancestor of Goliath. Wrong decisions. And also, she is said to have been just threshed by many men throughout her life. And according to writings, Orpah was believed to be actually a physical sister of Ruth. And her name was changed to Orpah because she turned her back on her mother-in-law. And so now we also understand that the Sanhedrin used to teach that she was killed by King David's general, Abishai. So you see how life turns out when we don't deal with bitterness and we don't deal with disappointment and we don't deal with unforgiveness. It doesn't fare well. So I want you to understand today, As a human being individually, and as a group of human beings, as African Americans, or whatever your culture may be, whatever your culture may have gone through, whatever may be happening in America today, do not allow bitterness to continue the oppression that we are now fighting to get out of. If life has been rough for you in the middle, and people have done you all manner of wrong, I implore you now, We're going to pray in just a moment, but I implore you now, do not let bitterness set in. Because we can't help in this nation with what we have to do, with the protests and the march and the representation. We can't help if we go out angry. We can't help if we go out bitter. It will not help our cause. Atrocities have been done. Some atrocities have been done in the name of this Bible, in the name of our God. But just like Naomi was wrong about the source of her problems, it is not God that has brought this upon any nation. It is absolutely the enemy. And anything that you are feeling in your life that you feel a man, some person brought upon you, they may have been the vessel, but it's the enemy. It is the enemy that comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So I implore you now, whatever it is that has seemingly tried to ravage your joy in your life, whatever the devil was trying to threaten you with and trying to tell you that's not going to happen in your life, I want you to speak the word of God. You shall live and not die. It shall be better. It shall be everything that God declared your life will be. You will live in vigor. You will have pails full of milk. Your progeny, your children, your grandchildren, your ancestors will call you blessed. But that will not happen until you have clean hands and a pure heart and no malice towards any man. And especially with what we're having to deal with in our nation today, especially with dealing with injustice, we cannot be caught on the other side of the coin. And we cannot allow the enemy to say to God, don't bless them, don't deliver them, because they have become just as bad as their oppressors. Now, if you don't know the Lord as your Savior, or you've fallen away from the Lord, or you just want prayer because maybe this message, this teaching has done something to prick your heart, we're going to pray right now. Father, I thank you for those that are listening, for those that have been accosted by the enemy, Lord God, and they feeling the strains of anger or bitterness, disharmony, or unforgiveness. I speak the peace of the Holy Spirit over every heart right now. And I thank you for deliverance. And now for those that don't know you as Lord and Savior, I want you to repeat this prayer after me. God, I know that you are the Father in heaven that sent Jesus to die for my sin. I believe he died on the cross. I believe he was buried and rose again on the third day. And I believe he's coming again in glory and majesty for his church. And by virtue of that, I receive the blood of Christ. I am born again. Fill me with your spirit for salvation and walking. And I thank you, Lord God, that you have come to set the captive free. If you pray that prayer, you're saved. I want you to hit the subscribe button or drop us a note and let us know that you turn your heart over to the Lord. Or I want you to go to Facebook and just like our page, send us a message and say, hey, I heard this message. It really helped me. It blessed me. I received the Lord when we prayed together. That would be such a blessing to us. I want to thank you for sending your gifts and your donations in to help this ministry to keep going. We have a lot that we want to do for mankind, for humanity. We have word that we want to get out to people. We thank you for helping us. If you would like to donate, please go to $LifeLifters Church or go to our website, www.lifelifterschurch.com, and you can give there by PayPal. Thank you for supporting and for supporting us with your viewership, supporting us with your prayers, supporting us with your finances. We thank our Life Lifters family for being faithful in their tithe and their offering, and understanding that our giving and our tithing is not just to meet a budget, but it's because the Bible says it is right to do so. I appreciate you for that. Until I see you next time, I want you to remember this one thing. There is no life like a lifted life. Take care.